In this problem, we're launching a projectile from ground level into the face of a cliff. So we're given all the parameters of the problem here. It's a 20 meter per second launch speed at an angle of 54 degrees above the horizontal, and the cliff face is 35 meters away. We're asked three questions. We want to compute the flight time for the projectile, then get the height at which it hits the cliff face, and then get the velocity vector when it hits the cliff face. So just to view that velocity vector real quick, it's like pointing in my picture down into the right. I'll call that V final vector. And it's really an open question whether or not this projectile is impacting the cliff face on its way down or on its way up. It just depends on how the numbers turn out, and then I'll comment on how we decide which one it is. So just to review real quick, the key to projectile motion problems is that the horizontal and vertical motion can be unlinked. And I can say that the horizontal motion is just given by this. X is equal to X naught plus V naught X times T. If I'm talking about motion with constant acceleration in general, then this is the equation, plus 1/2 AX T squared. But unique to projectile motion here is the fact that AX is equal to zero. There are no forces pushing or pulling horizontally on this projectile, so it has no acceleration horizontally. That means my X motion is the simplest possible motion. It's a constant velocity. And there's my X projectile motion equation. My Y motion, again, for a constant acceleration, looks like this in general. And the force of gravity induces a downward acceleration with a magnitude of G. So I plug that in, and I get Y equals Y naught plus V naught YT minus 1/2 GT squared. So there's my equations for projectile motion. Now, if I look at question A, give me the flight time for the projectile. Well, I happen to know the final X position for the projectile. It's at 35 meters right of the origin, which incidentally I should probably draw over here. Here's my origin. That's where X and Y are both equal to zero, right at the tail of that vector. So given that I have this information about the horizontal part of the motion, I'm going to start with a horizontal analysis of the problem. Before I get too far ahead of myself, we need to decompose this velocity vector into horizontal and vertical components so I can get the initial X velocity. And then for part B, I'll need the initial Y velocity. And that horizontal component, that's the adjacent leg of the right triangle. So I'm going to get hypotenuse times the cosine of 54. So Vx is going to be 20 cosine 54 degrees. I may as well get a decimal approximation in the picture while I'm working. To 3 sig figs, that's 11.8 meters per second. This Y component, well, I really just translated it over here from being the vertical leg of a right triangle. That's going to be 20 sine 54. So Vy equals 20 sine 54. And to 3 sig figs, that's 16.2 meters per second. So then I look at part A, compute the flight time for the projectile. And again, I noticed that the extra piece of information I have here is the final X coordinate. So I'm going to do a horizontal analysis. Just a word of warning here, the initial X velocity is not 20, it's just the component of that. So it's 11.8 in this case. And I know the final X position is 35, the initial is zero, the initial X velocity is 11.8 meters per second. This allows me to solve for the flight time. So I just divide by 11.8, and I get T. To 3 sig figs, I've got 2.97 seconds for the flight time. You may have noticed that I'm rounding everything to 3 sig figs as I go. That's just my rule of thumb, unless we're doing a problem where I'm particularly concerned with keeping track of the propagation of error. In part B, we want to know the height at which the projectile strikes the cliff. Now I know how long it's been in the air, so if I look at my vertical projectile motion equation, all I have to do is plug that time in there, and I've got the height at a time of 2.9 seconds. So y is equal to y naught, that's zero, plus v naught y times t, that's 16.2 meters per second times t. Again, the initial y velocity is not 20, it's just a component of that 20. Minus 1/2 times 9.8, g is 9.8, times 2.97 squared. When I run the numbers on this, I get a height of 4.89 meters. So it strikes the cliff face just a little less than 5 meters above the ground. Finally, we want to get the velocity vector at the moment of impact. So the way you approach this is you get the velocity components at the moment of impact, and then we're going to combine those into polar form. And the x one is the easy one. The x velocity at the moment of impact is equal to the x velocity at the moment of the launch, because the x velocity never changes because there's no acceleration horizontally. So that's just going to be 11.8 meters per second. The y velocity is a little more complicated. I have to appeal to my second kinematics equation for constant acceleration, the one that addresses velocity. That's v naught plus at. Come to think of it, I should probably just put that in the list up here. So vx is equal to v naught x. If I then consider what happens in the y direction, that velocity is changing because there's a vertical acceleration, and I appeal to my second kinematics formula that addresses changes in velocity. That's vy equals v naught y plus at, which specifically for a vertical free fall scenario or the y component of a projectile motion problem would give me v naught y minus gt, just subbing in negative g for the acceleration. So I start with my initial y velocity of 16.2 meters per second, and I go minus 9.8 times the amount of time the flight's been going on for, which is 2.97 seconds. This gives me a y velocity of negative 12.9 meters per second. And this is the moment that we realize the projectile impacts the face of the cliff on the way down. Now, I know I drew it that way in the picture from the beginning, but you can never really trust a picture until you run the numbers on it. Negative y component for the velocity means it's on the way down when it hits that cliff face rather than on the way up. So to wrap things up, we want to get the polar form of this thing. So I draw my x velocity vector, the rightward part of the motion, that's 11.8 meters per second. My y velocity vector, just slightly longer, is downward pointing because of that minus sign and has a magnitude of 12.9 meters per second. And there's my total impact velocity vector. And I'm going to label the angle of it right here. So to find the magnitude of that velocity, in other words, the speed of the impact, I use the Pythagorean theorem. The hypotenuse is the square root of the sum of the squares of the legs. I've got 17.5. meters per second for that. And then my impact angle, I'm just going to work in magnitudes here. I'm not keeping a minus sign on this 12.9. As long as I've got a picture with the angle labeled, I can just find an angle less than 90 degrees here and state that as the angle of impact. It's clear to anyone who reads it that I'm talking about an angle below the horizontal. So this angle is the angle whose tangent is opposite over adjacent here, 12.9 over 11.8. And I've got 47.5 degrees. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.